Welcome, my friends, to the Word. My name is Father Frank Nelson, and I am your host. The third Sunday of Advent is often called Gaudete Sunday. Gaudete is the Latin word for rejoice. It is the first word spoken by the angel Gabriel to the young Virgin Mary at the Annunciation, that wonderful day when Mary received word of God's plan for the salvation of the world in Jesus Christ. You know that in the Church of the Annunciation in Nazareth, which is built over a cave thought to be the humble home of Anne and Joachim, there is a plaque that simply states this fact: here the Word was made flesh. The joy of the angel's message is not always easy to find in today's world. So many people have the ingredients, but they don't use them correctly. I want to tell you a story. My grandfather used to make his delicious meatballs every Sunday morning. And when you look at the ingredients he used, the meat, the eggs, the cheese, the parsley, and the garlic, they mean nothing without the breadcrumbs which binds everything together. So it is with life. Many people may have the ingredients of wealth, or some just enough to get by. They may be healthy, famous, have a beautiful family, and even power and authority over other people. But they don't seem to be happy. Perhaps they lack the one thing that binds all the rest, that is Christ Jesus. Last week, we met John the Baptist in the Gospel of Mark, and this weekend we are turning to the Gospel of John to get into the mind of this great prophet through an interesting meeting between John the Baptist and the priests and the Levites. We begin to understand John's inner sense, his knowledge, that he was sent to prepare us, but that he himself is not the light. He knows that he is the voice that proclaims the joy that our lives will have if we simply move our Lord from the bottom of the list to those ingredients on the top. So many people forget that Jesus does not ever want us to go without family or money or enjoyment of life, but that true joy is only found when we acknowledge that those ingredients are the diamonds, the blessings that God gives us to do good with, but never to replace him as our God. And so the priests and the deacons will put on rose-colored vestments this weekend to remind us that something is different. Joy is near. We will recognize this joy in the life of the child born so many centuries ago. Or will we search for joy in getting the shopping done, the cookies baked, the tree decorated? Make sure you make your meatballs in life with that first ingredient that binds all others together: Christ, yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. And now we listen attentively to the word and the comments by our homilist, Deacon John Rapacki. And we pray, dear Lord, open our hearts. Let your Spirit speak to us as we ponder your holy word.
The Lord be with you. This is a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. A man named John was sent from God. He came for testimony, to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to him to ask him, "Who are you?" he had admitted and did not deny it, but admitted, "I am not the Christ." So they asked him, "What are you then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you, so we can give an answer to those who sent us? What do you have to say for yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.' As Isaiah said, the prophet said." Some Pharisees were also sent. They asked him, "Why then do you baptize, if you are not the Christ or Elijah or the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." This happened in Bethany across from Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord. Recently, I stopped at a convenience store to purchase a cup of coffee. As I approached the store, a man said to me, "Can you spare some loose change? I haven't had anything to eat and I am hungry." Upon entering the store, I purchased a bottle of orange juice and a buttered roll, and I asked the clerk to put it in a separate bag. Leaving the store, I handed the bag to the man and he said, "Thank you. God bless you." As I was getting into my truck, I noticed the man placing the buttered roll in the garbage receptacle next to him. He reached into his back pocket and placed what appears to be alcohol into the orange juice, and he began to drink it. Upon seeing this, I became angry, for I felt that I was duped. This man, I surmised, just wanted something for nothing, and he got it. A couple of weeks later, I was entering another convenience store to buy yet another cup of coffee when a woman approached me and asked, "Can you spare some loose change? I am out of work and I have two children to feed." Upon entering the store, I purchased a bottle of orange juice and a buttered roll, and I asked the clerk to put it in a separate bag. Leaving the store, I handed the bag to the woman and she said, "Thank you. God bless you." As I was entering my truck, I noticed the woman going to the side of the store. Out of curiosity, I decided to exit the parking lot on that side of the building to see where she might be going. I saw the woman sitting in a wooded area next to the store with two little children, and she was breaking the bread for the children to eat. I parked my truck and asked them if I could join them. They welcomed my company. What I discovered was not despair, but great joy. This woman of faith explained to me that she trusted God would provide for her and her children, and he did by my act and the act of many others. Far too often we have experiences that teach us that what we think we see may not be what is real. These experiences cause us to be cynical and untrusting. It can become the perfect excuse to justify our blindness to the needs of those in despair. In today's gospel, we experience the testimony of John, a man sent from God to testify about the light, so all might believe through him. Simply put, John's vocation is to witness to Jesus. The question for us today is, how did John fulfill his role as witness? And what are the implications for us as followers of Jesus? Let us first consider motivation. What was the driving force behind the work of John? For the answer, we can look at our own lives. Have you ever loved doing something so much that it was not work? Like cooking, crocheting, being a husband, wife, or friend. You could perform this task 24 hours a day, and it never seems tiring or boring. Or have you ever experienced the joy of anticipation as you await the arrival of someone you love deeply? A childhood friend, an old neighbor, niece, nephew, spouse, or child. The life of John the Baptist, despite his sacrifices and hardships, was full of joy, if you define joy as the state of bliss over having or expecting something or someone that you love. For John, the coming of Jesus and his relationship with God was his joy. As for John himself, much is revealed in how he answered the religious authorities. The first question was quite direct: "Who are you?" It is a question, perhaps unspoken, which is continually asked of us by others, and hopefully by ourselves too. John made it clear that he was not the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet akin to Moses. Like John, we too need to say who we are not, to have a healthy understanding that we are not defined by the expectations of others, nor by our jobs, or even our family. When pressed, John does in fact tell his questioners who he is. His answer is startling and unique. John quotes a verse from Isaiah, "I am the voice of the one crying out in the desert, make straight the way of the Lord." Like John's response, our self-definition should give expression of our singularity, our creativity, and our beauty. When John was asked about his authority, "Why do you baptize?" John points, as he did so many times before, to the one whom he loved, the one who brings him great joy, Jesus, the one to whom he wasn't fit to unfasten his sandals. In John the Baptist, we see a model for our spirituality, knowing our smallness and nothingness, that we are not worthy to untie even the sandal strap of the Lord. John pointed away from himself to Jesus. John's humility maintains his faith and hope, and from these comes joy. Like the woman that I met outside the convenience store, even the most trying times can be filled with joy as long as you have faith and hope in the Lord. This joy, however, is not reserved for those in need only, but is also the grace of those who show love and compassion. My experience with the man jaded me so that even though I did what was right the second time, I doubted myself and distrusted the woman, causing me to drive around the corner to see if she had lied or not. In that moment, I doubted the goodness of people. But when I saw the woman and her children, I was reminded of my humility and how easy it is to be doubtful. But I was filled with joy and a renewed faith, knowing that our sacrifice and concern for others is always respected, appreciated, and valued by God. This week, as we continue our Advent celebration, I encourage each of you to ask yourself that question asked of John: who are you? Are you that humble, joy-filled witness God calls you to be? In these days, that often takes courage, but it is not beyond your reach. Become that ray of sunshine to a sometimes dark and dreary world, wherever you may be, always pointing to the source of all joy, Jesus.